Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
We kind of planned on wrapping this series and kind of went off on some different places, didn't quite really wrap as a summary, and all of our recording got messed up, so we did not get anything last week. So for the benefit of those viewing, we're going to do some, now it won't be the same. I never do anything twice the same. I could go in there with the same notes and even try to read them. And it'll come out different. So, hallelujah. But we're glad to have you. Glad to have all y'all tonight. And we are and have been teaching on what? Healing? What's the subtitle? Come on now. A redemptive reality or truth. Okay. All right, so we've been teaching on healing being a redemptive truth. In other words, it is included in the plan of redemption. Can you say amen? It is included in the plan of redemption. It is part of what Jesus did for us. We get that from a couple of places. Number one, we get it from, I'm trying to use markers that maybe show up better on the, we haven't been able to really get this to show up good for those watching at home or watching on the internet. We get this from the covenant name of God. Now, Dr. Schofield, Dr. Schofield, in his Bible, in reference to the name of God, calls it the distinctive covenant name of God. I know you all have heard this over and over and over, but it is the basis for everything we're teaching. Okay, and that the hyphenated names, there are seven, hyphenated, all right, you just help me here if I mess this up. I'm not sure if I got that right. I don't have spell checker up here, so, all right, names, the seven hyphenated names do what? They point to an increasing self-revelation. By God. Okay. So an increasing self-revelation by God to declare who he is. All right. And so we have seven hyphenates. So we have, we have Yahweh, and and again, this is translated, your King James Bible, small caps, is Lord. It's also translated Yahweh, or, as most people probably have heard it, Jehovah. And you can see the YH, the WH, a couple of vowels put in, created Yahweh. In the dramatic, they gave the J for the Y. So you had the YH and the V, you had, for the W, because in dramatic language, that's what we do. So we have, and put the vowels in, so you had the YH, WH, and add the vowels, you get Jehovah, by changing that to a J and that to a Y. So that's where these came from. So if you hear Yahweh, you hear Jehovah, you see it in all caps, it's still talking about this word right here. All right? So this is what? The distinctive covenant name of God to his covenant people. He is Yahweh. He is Jehovah. He is the Lord of the covenant. All right? And then he had seven hyphenated names. And most important, we talked about this, how that if God, God chose to reveal himself in Exodus 15:26. And this is the first of the seven names, of the seven hyphenated names, seven names. Okay? Yahweh, and then the very next one, we put a hyphen in it, it is, and then it's Rapha. What? What is that? The Lord that heals thee. Okay? So it is the Lord, or Yahweh, or Jehovah that heals thee, or the Lord thy physician. Okay, so either one. So what God reveals in this here from these this Hebrew wording of the covenant that He's God. He is the Lord of the covenant. He is hyphenated. And, of course, we know there are other names. There's the Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness, Jehovah Nisi, the Lord our banner of victory, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace, Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. There's seven of these in the Old Testament. But each one reveals who God is. Okay, and then we talked about last week, how that Jesus came, and Hebrews 1, well, this that bad boy is just not writing real good. Hebrews 1, 1 through 3 say what? God in these last days has spoken, this is what we talked about last week, to us, how? By His Son. So what are we saying? God, remember that John 1:1, we talked about this last week, John 1:1 through verse 14, really, you know, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God, and, you know, and all things created by Him, da-da-da-da-da, so forth. Then verse 14, and the Word was made flesh, or and the word here for Word is logos in the Greek, okay? And this word means the full discourse, the full discourse, okay? Whereas rhema would be a part or a spoken word or something that had been revealed out of the full discourse, okay? So you have a rhema word. It's more of a revelation of this, where logos is the full discourse. Jesus is the full discourse of God, okay? He is the complete full revelation of God. And the Bible says that God, in Hebrews 1, spoke to us by His Son. He spoke to us by the Logos. And so we took that and we carried it to this end that God reveals who He is to us in the ministry of Jesus. In the Old Testament, He used names, which was and that very important, because we're able to substantiate this because of this. Okay, we're able to say yes, He's the healer, because Jesus went and healed. But God declared to us in the covenant, He is the Lord that heals us. Jesus was our righteousness, and in His ministry He provided, in His ministry He delivered, in His ministry He was peace. And so we see here that we have this has a basis in what and the fact that God does what, or God does not do what? God changes not. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus is the same what? Yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus never changes. Now, excuse me just a second before I trip. I'm stepping on my shoelace. And am I out of camera range? For all the lovely people who are watching, hey, don't get to see me tie my shoe. Hallelujah. And so here we have it. We have the God of the covenant, okay? The distinctive name of God, He is Lord, Yahweh, Jehovah. Same thing. These are all, like I said, once again, these are all the same. Okay? We're talking about translations into English. We're talking about transliterations. We're talking about, you know, giving us English equivalents, et cetera, et cetera. But this, and of course, these are transliteration letters of the Hebrew lettering into Aramaic lettering, or what we use for our alphabet. Okay? Arabic. And so we use that 26-letter alphabet. It's not symbol based like the Hebrew is. Okay, and so these are the transliteral values of those Hebrew lettering into this. So we get, you know, the YH, WH, and then strength. We English Lord Yahweh Jehovah, God, the God of the covenant. God chooses to reveal the very first time in Exodus 15:26, the first of His seven hyphenated names. He is the Lord that heals thee. And so this is what this is. He is the Lord. He is the covenant God. So that heals you. Remember, God's covenant with man was his act of redemption. Now, under the old covenant, we were redeemed or atoned for, covered for a coming time when he could redeem us. Okay? So we got a new covenant. It's on better promises. Why? Because under the old, they got covered. Next year, they had to come right back and go through the whole same process and get it all taken care of once again because it wasn't washed away. So under the old, you had atonement. Under the new, you have redemption. Okay. So, here we are with the covenant God. He's revealed himself as the Lord that heals. Jesus comes, and Hebrews declares, Paul writing Hebrews. I believe when Paul wrote Hebrews. You don't have to believe that. I just believe he did. But like one guy said, I wonder who wrote the book of Hebrews. Anyway, all right. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. He spoke to us by what? The Logos. And then the Logos tabernacled. That's what the word means there in John 1:14. Tented in a tabernacle. Cold. Okay. And the word was made flesh. This is what the word dwelt means. Dwelt means tabernacle. You could literally translate it, tabernacle or tented. And so in the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, his only begotten Father. The word was made flesh and tabernacled among us. And then we see the ministry of Jesus. This is what we really got into last week. How that when Jesus went round about the villages, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, teaching in their synagogues, and healing all manner of sickness and disease among the people, what was happening? God was speaking to us. God was speaking to us by the Logos, by his Son, by the Logos of God. Okay, not the sermon, but by what Jesus was doing, the full embodiment of what he was doing. It was God speaking to us. So, why? Because Hebrews 1 says he was the express image of his person. Here, Hebrews 1:1-3, he was the express image of his person, the brightness of his glory. And it happened, these last days spoken to us by him. And so he was the exact representation of the Father. Glory be to God. Can somebody say glory be to God? Hallelujah. He represented the Father. Amen? And so we have Jesus on the earth. Okay? I'll make that an E, a little better looking E. All right. We'll just cover all that one word. Okay, heals thee. All right. So God, we have this teaching we've been doing on the covenant of God. That God was our covenant God. And under the Old Testament, he was the covenant God of Israel. He is still our covenant God. Now, there are a lot of people who kind of come over to the New Testament and try to get... I'm not sure what they try to get. Sometimes I can't read it real well. And I don't want to say something that's really wrong. But it comes across like, well, we don't have a covenant with God. We have a relationship with God. And being in intimate relationship with God is the most important thing. And I will say to that, amen. Except it's still a covenant. God does what he does on the basis of covenant. It started with Adam in the Garden of Eden. We call it the Adamic covenant, where he killed the animals and slew them and shed their blood and covered them in animal skins. We had the Mosaic covenant. We had the Abrahamic covenant. We've got the new covenant. Okay, God has dealt with man with covenants, and even under the New Testament, New Testament is the Old English word for covenant. Okay, so the New Testament really is the new covenant. It's still a covenant, and it was made between God and the man Christ Jesus. Why? Because that way it can never be annulled. It can never be done away with. It can never fail. Now you may fail in it, but it can't fail. Okay, I like that passage where Paul's writing. He says, "If we deny him, if we do this, he'll do that. If we do this, he'll do that. If we're unfaithful, he abideth faithful. God just can't be unfaithful. Okay, he's going to be the same. All right, why? Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah! Glory to God. Amen. What's this telling us? Jesus comes. He's the express image of the Father. Everything he does was, you know, remember Jesus said this in John's Gospel. We repeated this over and over. In John's Gospel, Jesus said, if you see me, let's just, that black was really had a lot of juice to it. See me, you see the Father. That's what he told Philip. Remember that? He told Philip. Have I been with you so long, Philip? And you don't understand? He that's seen me has seen the Father. Jesus said, I only do those things which I see my Father do. I only do those things which I see my Father do. I don't have him running around making folks sick. He doesn't walk up to well people who are just minding their own business, come up and put, I'm putting leprosy on you. Why? You need a lesson. What? You'll figure it out someday. When? We don't have any of that in the Bible. And they just did, they wanted to make sure everything looked good. The Bible is full of stuff we don't that was not good. David and Bathsheba is not a love story. It's an adultery story, murder, conspiracy to commit murder, and everything else. God didn't hide the dirty laundry of the failures of his people. Why? Because in the failures of his people, he is able to reveal the greatness of his grace and mercy. Hallelujah. And how he can take the failure and turn it into victory. Or in the midst of that failure, create victory. We have one guy said one time, and I vehemently disagree with his perspectives. David and Bathsheba was God's will. How do you know? Solomon. No. David and Bathsheba were adulterers. They were sin. They were not God's will. He didn't get out of ahead of God and get Bathsheba. Are you here? Uriah beat him to her. Well, Uriah was going to die early. Only because David had him killed. Are you here? That is not a love. It is not a sign that God had a plan for David and Bathsheba all along because Solomon came. Solomon came after the death of the one who was conceived in the adultery. And that child died. David fasted and mourned to have that child not die, and then he died. Anyway, are you here? Remember, when he got the new child died, he cleansed himself, and they said, why aren't you mourning? He said, Okay? So here we have this. Then David and Bathsheba conceived Solomon after they're married, and Solomon becomes great. Why? Not because it was always God's plan, but that God was stating, I can come into the midst of destruction of my plan, destruction of my will, I can restore, I can bring glory out of the mess. This is what the scripture, I know I'm not reviewing, but I'm going to say it anyway. This is where the scripture, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. That does not mean when you got hit by a Mack truck, that's to the glory of God. God can come into the middle of the mess and fix it. Amen? If somebody dies lost, that doesn't work together for the glory of God. Okay? The all things is not referencing everything that happens to you. It is the all things of God's mercy, of all God's grace, of God's goodness, of God demonstrating himself. And if you take it that it means all things, everything that happens in your life. And when you study in context and get past theological perspectives and get your bias, or actually your theological bias, when you study the whole context around that, you can't come away from them going, man, cancer works together for good. Why? Jesus said the thief came to kill, steal, and destroy, I've come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Now God, when Satan shows up to kill, steal, and destroy, God can show up and do great things. and bring restoration and bring wholeness. So David and Bathsheba were not, Hollywood makes it a little strange. You've probably all seen the movie with, the actor of the day who was the, he was really big. I mean, he was like, for that era, he was like super buff. And Jesse's there going, who is it? Who is it? Who is it? Who is it? Victor Mature. That's right. Victor Mature. Thank you. That's exactly who it was. You know, and they make it a love story. Let me put it, it was a lust story. It was a hormonal story. Okay? And that was, he was Samson. I'm sorry, that wasn't David and Bathsheba. That was Samson. That was Samson and Delilah. That was the movie with Samson and Delilah, Victor Mature. And another lust story. Hello? You know, so that one, I got off with all that because God didn't have the dirty laundry. You're right. That was a classic, but it was Samson and Delilah. That's who that was. Now I don't remember David and Bathsheba. It could have been Victor Mature. He may have been the dude of all those films. It's kind of like what's his name was all the Tarzan movies right. Back then and stuff. Victor Mature was the stud of the day. Was he in the robe? Okay. All right. So here we have it. We don't need. I'm going to get off on Hollywood trivia, and I got to finish this. Sheesh. All right. Hallelujah. Well, if we keep that up, we'll keep reviewing for the next 6 months. All right, and that'd be my fault. So, how did that? There we go. In John's Gospel, he that's seen me has seen the Father. That blue just ain't cutting it. All right. He that's seen me has seen the Father. I only do those things which I see my Father do. God changes not. God spoke to us by His Son. He is the Logos. So the truth is in redemption. Now, let's go to some scriptures here. Let's go look, or we'll talk about them, okay? Because we already covered them once. Remember in Isaiah, I'm going to pick that up again, okay? Isaiah 50, actually it starts in 52 right down there around verse 13 and goes into 53, okay? And we get down verse 1 through 8 or so, okay? This is prophesying about the coming who? Redeemer. Okay, talking about the coming Redeemer. And so we find in Isaiah, come on, open. Here we go. Thank you very much for cooperating with me, my machine. So when Jesus comes, talking about God's suffering servant, we're talking about here in Isaiah 52, and it was down right at the very end, verse 50, 13 of Isaiah 52. He goes, behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. As many as were astonished at thee. His visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Fathom the cross. Darkness had to come on the face of earth. They could not look on what they, human eye would not be able to look on what they saw. Now, the closest depiction to the cross we have in any movie is Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ. Now, just in case you're wondering why they use the word passion, in Old English, the word passion meant sufferings. It didn't mean you're passionate about people. It meant sufferings. The Greek word translated passion means suffer. So the suffering of Christ. Okay? More than any man, and for his form more than the sons of men. He didn't look like a man. You think about this, all sickness, all sin coming on him at the cross. After he had been beaten with a Roman scourging of 40 stripes save one, that's 39 lashes. With the Roman, listen, it's not the cowboy bullwhip, you know, the long whip with the little. This was a Roman scourging, handle about this long, and on the handle tethers, leather tethers about this long, about an inch and a half wide, and in the end they had bone or rock or glass or you know pot clay, you know, broken pottery. Nails and all that, and just anything that would shred, and they would wrap that. That's when Mel Gibson, remember, I don't know if you saw that, he actually was beaten, but he had on real thick leather covering. So when they hit it, but his belly got cut some because those things went around and wrapped and actually caught him where that leather wasn't protecting in the making of the movie. Okay? And when they would come across, and that was done. Now listen, it wasn't 39 stripes by one soldier. Typically, a Roman scourging had three men doing the 39 lashes each. Okay? And so they would come across Jesus and pull that back. And, you know, the leather, the constant slamming of the leather against your back would begin to tear the skin open. But then those the different things in there, like I said, the nails, the clay, the rocks, whatever, in the end of those tethers, when they drug it back, would just shred the skin. Then they took rods and beat him. They actually plucked his beard. Now, how many have gone somewhere and gotten an eyebrow? Boop. You know? You go in, you know, and they go, oh, you got the unibrow, so we're going to take out the few in there in the middle. And you're going, just a couple eyebrows. They plucked his beard out. Now, my wife, if I get like a wild hair in my eyebrow or something, hold still, honey. I'm like, Bink. I missed it. Bink. Woman, get it. Get the right one next time. Come on now. I lost four. You trying to get to the one. Jeff's fucking down. Jeff's over here talking about nose hairs. All right. And in Isaiah 53. Now, so they plucked his beard. Now, you think about this. All he had gone through in the scourging and then went to the cross, and then sin and sickness and disease came on him. All sin. He was made sin for us who knew no sin. Okay? He took on death. He took on his body took on every sickness and disease. And the Bible says, His visage was marred more than that of any man or the sons of men. So he shall sprinkle the nations. The kings shall shut their mouths at him. For what they had not seen, they told him they shall see. And that which they had not heard, they shall consider. Isaiah 53:1 is not a new chapter. It is a continuation of what started in verse 13 here. Okay? Why they stuck the chapter mark there? The English. Who knows? 53 should have started in verse 13 if we're talking about trying to keep continuity and so forth. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant out of a root of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and we shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. Let me say this. Jesus was not GQ. Now, right now, the generation people we have now, they're so television image driven that, you know, they want the ministers to be hip, cool, slick, imageable, marketable. But the Bible says that the king himself had no form nor comeliness that we should desire, or no beauty that we should desire him. They weren't attracted to him because he was a man's man, and, you know, he was going to the cover of GQ and everybody wanted to be like him. No, I don't want to be like Fabio. I'm sorry. I rocked the long hair back in high school. Some of my old high school buddies may remember that. You know, 1 year, I had it for 1 year, and then went after baseball. It was time for baseball, and I went from about just below my shoulders to halfway my ears overnight. So, hey, baseball season. It's, who cares about cool? It's time to play ball, baby. All right. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Now, we have two Greek words here, Hebrew words, I'm sorry, not Hebrew, Greek, Hebrew. We have koile, C-H-O-L-I, all right, and makab, M-A-K-O-B. And brother, I don't have it right here. I got a different Bible. See, I got it written in a different Bible. I believe the first one is koile, sorrows, which means sicknesses. In Greece, makab meant pains or so forth. So he hath carried our sicknesses, he has borne our sicknesses and carried our pains, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. So Isaiah begins to declare in his prophecy that redemption or salvation, or let me say this, spiritual salvation and physical healing are part of what Jesus is paying the price for. So we have that, and I hear people get really, really, I mean, they'll put on their spiritual voice. That is talking about the spiritual sickness of sin. Okay. I'll let you have your argument for a moment until I disprove it. And I'm not going to disprove it for my opinion. If you will, go with me to 1 Peter 2:24. Now, this is Old Testament. I understand that. But in the New Testament, we come to 1 Peter 2:24. I really wish this was showing up really good on the internet. I don't know if it is. If you can see it well enough to be able to see, I regret it if it's not. But does it show up better on our record, once we actually record? Or do we know? We don't know. Okay. We do put this out later on our YouTube, folks, if you're watching, our YouTube, which is what, Faith and Victory Church, or FVC, we don't know, FVC.org. Our YouTube is FVC.org, and so you can go out and watch it out there, FVC.org, and get the recorded of this. If you're watching live and want to see, maybe it gets clearer, I don't know. But 1 Peter 2:24 says what? Who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. This is almost a verbatim quote of verse 5 here in Isaiah. Okay? So we have, you know, he chastised our peace upon him. He was wounded for our transgressions. That's what sins. He was bruised for our iniquities. So iniquities and transgressions are our sin and sin nature. Okay? Chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes were healed. Peter comes back and says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. Now, I've heard people come, others say, oh, that was for the Jew. Oh my gosh. Peter's writing to the church. He ain't writing to the Jew. Hello? Y'all hear, you go home. And it's not the spiritual sickness of sin. You don't get healed from your sin. You get born again. And that's probably what we're going to next in our teaching, is the new birth. All right? You get born again. Your spirit does not get healed. It gets born again. Old things passed away. All things became new, and all things are of God. That's not healing. That is complete transformation. Your spirit gets completely transformed from death unto life. Some of the scriptures that people read, they're not understanding the difference between the spirit, soul, and body. A lot of things they're trying to apply to the spiritual, really to the soul. Renew your mind, you know. Put off the old man, put on the new man. That's talking about in your thoughts and in how you conduct yourself. That's not talking about your spirit. Your spirit's born again. Okay? It's alive unto God. All right. So we have 1 Peter 2:24, which quotes Isaiah 53:5. Okay? And you could probably get away with it if it just didn't happen to be for a little sneaky scripture called Matthew 8:16-17. That kind of messes up your argument that it was spiritual. Look over Matthew. Now, we already covered this in this teaching, so this technically is review. Okay? I'm getting away on a technicality. Okay. When evening was come, they brought on him many that were possessed with devils. He cast out the spirits with his word and healed all that were sick, that it might be fulfilled by which Isaiah the prophet the prophet saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. It's not talking about spiritual. The sickness part is talking about physical healing. Yes, God takes care of the spiritual. That's covered in the other part. Whose own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin shall live unto righteousness. That's covering the sin part. By whose stripes you were healed was covering the physical. We stated earlier in our teaching in Psalm. That is a terrible way to start a 103, verses 1 through 4. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. And what? Look at it. Turn there. Psalm 103. Forget not all his, come on, benefits. Now, folks, I love God. I really do. But he told me not to forget his benefits. So if I come to him because I need healing, I am not coming looking for a sugar daddy. I'm coming because they told me to do it that way. He said, I got a benefit for you. Now, I'm going to mess with you. You out there on the internet, I'm going to mess with you. We think that by going, I can't come to God and ask him to heal me because that just means I'm trying to get something out of him. But he told me to come that way. That's Old Testament. Yeah, have you ever read Hebrews? Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. When? When everything's hunky-dory. In the time of need. Okay? Hebrews. I will find it. You get some scriptures and they're not in your notes for the night, and then you got to go, where is it? Oh, where is it? Hebrews 4:16. Let me back up here. Hebrews 4, verse 14. Okay? So, let's kind of get this Hebrews 4. Oh, 14 through 16 in here. All right? Because it kind of parallels us a little bit. All right? Seeing then we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. The word profession in the Greek can be translated profession or confession. Okay? And it when it makes this kind of statement, it's a reference to your profession or confession of faith. All right? For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. In other words, he was tempted in every point of life, just like we are, to fail, to quit, to give up, to sin, to do all, but he didn't sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in what? The time of need. Not when everything's hunky dory. God, and why? Because he's having compassion on us. Sympomuno. Okay? Sympomuno in Greek. Compassion, sympathy. More the idea of compassion and not I'm so sorry you feel that way. But the compassion to feel what they feel. Remember, we don't have a high priest who can't be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Okay? He has compassion. He has sympomuno. He feels it. And he longs to minister to us out of his wealth of resources or benefits. Did I spell benefits right? It just don't look right. Thank you. Dick's my spell checker. I'm looking at it going, bugging me, I don't look right. Well, anyway, yeah. How many have ever done that? Aren't you glad you're not doing today with a typewriter and a correction ribbon or whiteout? Sheesh. The hammer mark was still there. You just got to. So I turn in type papers. If you held it to the light, splot, 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 splot. Hallelujah. Yeah, we got. So Psalm 103 tells us what? Bless the Lord, O my soul. We didn't quite quote this. We kind of moved on, but I'm going to come back now. Let me kind of take what we're doing here and bring it back up here. Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. bless his holy name, and forget not his benefits. Now, understand, the psalmist says, bless the Lord. We are to have a relationship with the Lord. It's not just show up at the bank and make withdrawals because somebody's making deposits. Hello? I have a relationship with my Father. You have a relationship with the Father. Amen? Glory to God. We have that relationship with him. So, and then he says this, don't forget his and forget not his benefits. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who crowneth thy life with loving kindness. Oh, praise the Lord. So I find out from here that my Father forgives me and heals me. Now, I found out from here that the healing they're talking about in Scripture, Isaiah 53, 1 Peter 2, 24, Matthew 8, is in reference to physical diseases. Now I come to Hebrews, and he tells me to do what? When I'm in a time of need, come to the throne of grace with boldness. Don't put on the wimpy pants. See, that's what I was kind of going down this path a little bit. We adopt the narrative that it is humility to reject the benefits. Let me say something. I'm going to hide it from the camera. It is not humility. Are you here with me? It is not humility to reject his benefits. It actually is arrogance. Did I spell that right, Dick? Yeah, they're like the arrogant. Okay, thank you. Spell checker. It's arrogance. What do you mean it's arrogance? You're saying, I don't need his benefits. I can handle it myself. Oh, no, no, no. You're not being humble. You have to acknowledge you need his help. And he made the provision of the benefits to help you in the time of need. Are you here? So the devil has sold you a bill of goods. You're being humble, and really you're being arrogant. I'm going to give all our internet viewers an opportunity. Shoot me with your Nerf guns. Get it out of your system. All right. It really is. He provides the benefits, and you say, oh, I just need to love you. I don't need these. And he says, yes, you do. That's why I made them benefits, because you need them. It's like, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. No, I got it. Arrogance. And what we think is arrogance is really humility. To come to God and expect God to heal my body when he gave it to me as a benefit, they call that arrogance. God sees it as humility because why? I recognize I have to throw myself on dependency on him. I'm recognized. I mean, in one way, don't think I even agree with it, but in one way, if you kind of look at it, what Ted Turner said a number of years ago was right. Christianity is a crutch for people. Absolutely. I need him. I can't make it on my own. I'm not going to do the things God wants me to do. I'm not going to be the man God wants me to be. I can't live the way God wants me to live without him. So call it a crutch, call it whatever you want to call it. I call it a dependency on the greater one. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? I need God. Amen. So you can get up there and be, you know, with your atheistic vision, that's just a crutch for weak people. I don't care. Yeah. Paul said, I rejoice in my weaknesses. Why? That the power of Christ may rest upon me. Glory to God. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. See, everybody thinks Paul's thorn was ophthalmia. I probably just mutilated that, but it's an oriental eye disease at the time. Pussy discharge from his eyes. Hey, what are you talking about? And they came up with that because he wrote in Galatians, see how big letters I write. And you would have plucked out your own eyes. That gave them, he had the oriental eye disease. Baby, are you talking about sometimes people come up with some stretches? I mean, they ought to be in the what's that? Is it the Expendables or whatever? The cartoon characters from Disney? Incredibles, the Incredibles. Mr. Stretch. Yep. You have stretched that one, baby. No, I recognize that without God and without His benefits, I cannot make it. I am not going to have a victorious life consistently, day by day, without Him. I need Him. Amen? I need His life in me. I need to be able to go to Him in the time of need. And He said, He didn't say come groveling. He didn't say come whining. He said come boldly in the time of need. Why? Because the throne of grace is full of I can't make them in all caps now. Bodily, yeah. Well, I'm bringing my body too. Hallelujah.
That's right.
Listen, this is not a spelling contest. I am not in the national spelling bee. All right? I'm coming boldly because there are benefits. I'm not coming like, you owe me. I'm coming because you told me to come that way. And I'm submitting to your will of how to approach you. Listen, there's an Old Testament scripture. I don't have it in my notes, but there's an Old Testament scripture that says this. The way King James translates it is this. Concerning my promises, command ye me. Now listen, I don't for a second think God means for us to come out and go, hey, I'm telling you, big guy, you better get down here and do this. No, that's not what it means. Actually, the Hebrew kind of comes more across of demand ye me. Now, let me say this. When it says concerning my promises, command or make a demand, I believe you're saying make a demand on me, on my promises. Isaiah 45:11. Okay, thank you. See, and now it would be arrogance to come and go, you got to do it. To get in the face of God and tell Him He's got to do something. Okay? But Isaiah 45:11, concerning my promises, command ye me. Make a demand. What? Come to the throne of grace boldly. The time of need. Make a demand on what? The benefits. Because He provided it. Why did He provide it? John 3:16 summarizes it. We all know this verse. God so loved agape. God so unconditionally loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus came into the world to reveal the Father. And the interesting thing is, it's still the covenant, but what Jesus did, He took Yahweh from simply the God in heaven, the God of the covenant, to the Father. He further revealed who God was by revealing the Father heart of God. He's still the God who changes not. He's still the God of the covenant. But Jesus came to introduce the Father heart in all of these covenant benefits and all of these covenant things. It's a Father with His children. He wants them to be blessed with good things. If ye being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall the Father give the Holy Ghost to them that ask Him? Actually says this, if you being good, you know how to give gifts unto, will you give your child a stone if he asks for a fish? In other words, will you do, he's saying, look, even in an evil generation, you're good to your children. How much more? How much more the Father give good gifts to them that ask. And then he goes, actually the Holy Spirit to them that ask. So the Father heart gets revealed, but the Father still has the benefits. How do you know? Because Jesus came and spoke for the Father. The Father spoke through Jesus to us. healed, cast out devils, made provision, brought peace. Glory to God. So we see the benefits in action in the ministry of Jesus. And then after Jesus has ascended into the throne of God and sits down at the right hand of God, where he ever lives to make intercession for us, the writer of Hebrews, which I believe is Paul, came and said now in chapter 4, verse 16, he said, let us come boldly. Why? Because we don't have a high priest. Now, Jesus' ministry is now the high priestly ministry of Jesus. He's at the right hand of the Father making the intercession for us. That's a high priestly ministry. He's no longer walking the earth. He has sat down at the right hand of the Father, and he's praying for us and interceding for us and arguing our case on the basis of his... I know I can spell this one right without help. On the basis of his blood.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.